Dick Owen is a long way from home. 22 years ago, in September 1980, his son, Johnny Owen, fought for a world boxing title. He fought and died. Dick was in Johnny's corner that night. The father was also his son's trainer. Johnny Owen, the Merthyr matchstick man, painfully slender, massively courageous. This is the story of a fight. It is also the story of a journey to Mexico to meet the man, Lupe Pintor, whose blows killed Johnny Owen. This is Dick Owen's Search for Peace.
For 21 years I've cried, and I'm hoping this will settle it all now. I hope. I'd like to see Pinta now after all these years and see how he has got on, like, you know. No, I'd like to meet him now.
Va a ser un encuentro de dos amigos, creo yo. De dos amigos que algún día libramos una gran batalla, como una guerra, pero sucede. En las guerras hay muertos, hay guerras injustas. Cuando yo me encuentre con el papá de Johnny va a ser algo emocionante y va a ser algo que nos va a traer recuerdos bonitos y tristes. Pero sí, sí quiero volver a verlo.
He was not the fault for what happened to Johnny. There was a chink in John's armor, which we didn't know about. Not, that's the saddest part about it. If we'd only known, like. I don't know what they're going to say to him now. I think it's going to be very emotional. I think myself, anyway.
Boxing. A link between Mexico City and Merthyr Tydfil, two places otherwise almost impossibly far apart. Merthyr, the bleak, battered iron town with a rich history of producing boxing champions, and home to Johnny Owen. He was one of eight children, the third of five sons. When it came to sport, there was only one choice.
I was interested. The boys were taking up boxing, that there wouldn't be abuses. Myself, I think everybody should do a little bit of boxing. It gives you character. It was good for John anyway. I took interest in him. I used to go down to the gym to watch him. I also started a gym in my own house. I had a big swing out the back and I had to put punch bags up on it and start them off, like, you know.
We did all the training together, went round fighting together, fought for Wales together. Well, I did it for about 10 years, and John, obviously, when I packed in, John obviously kept on, and he was the better boxer of us all.
John was devoted to it. The amount of time that he put into it, like, you know. It's easy to train John. The hardest part was to stop him training.
I knew he was a very good boy, but he was so small, very small, but when he's about 15, 16, very thin, small. He was a flyweight for a long time, but he matured into a bantamweight, and then, you know, we had a good boy. There's something special about him.
Johnny, how are you going to approach this fight? Like to all the others, how's that? Like getting the ring, series, like...
He didn't have so much raw talent, but he was so dedicated, and he was so strong and fit, that the talent came later, he developed it.
You'd overdo it, like, you know, you had to stop him. Man. He'd run forever, man.
He was very aggressive in the ring, yeah. Very aggressive. He won most of his opponents down to me. stopped a hell of a lot of his opponents. You got to be very thorough, Johnny. Put up the ring, he always laughed and giggled and joked about everything.
How do you celebrate after this?
Well, I've got into so tight, they celebrate for me.
Johnny was determined that he would never drink or go out with a girl or do anything stupid until he finished boxing.
You've got to give 100%, and it's no good having a girl courting and coming around and she hanging about while he's training all the time, and it's not fair on the girl. I said to leave it there and just put 100% in, make the money and get out of it. He called me Dick when we run around. And if anybody's else around, he called me Dad. Big friends we were. We weren't father and son. There's something closer.
Mexico City is an even more fertile breeding ground for boxers than Merthyr. Here, the same old rules apply, that this hard game might provide an escape to wealth and fame, just as it did for Lupe Pinto.
En la colonia siempre es un barrio donde los grandes a veces humillan a los chicos. En mi tiempo se daba eso y fue uno de los motivos principales por los que yo me metí a boxear, para defenderme de los grandulones y algún día pegarles. Desgraciado ser eso, pero encontré el camino para triunfar en la vida. Al que se metía conmigo no le iba muy bien. Entonces, de esa manera, me hice respetar de toda la gente de aquí. Aparte que posteriormente, ya con el tiempo, me fui haciendo famoso poco a poco y bueno, eso también implica mucho respeto para uno. Cuando tenía 16 años, me invitaron a representar un equipo aquí mismo de México, en Centroamérica, Suramérica, y ahí fue en donde yo empecé a ganar un poquito de dinero. Posteriormente, como profesional, ya me dieron un buen sueldo y me nació el amor más por esto, porque había dinero.
Pinto, known as El Indio, soon had the reward of a title. He became the WBC Bantamweight World Champion. Johnny Owen, too, rose through the rankings after he turned professional at the age of 20.
All his fights stood out, every one of them. But when he took the 12th title, that stood out. Then he took the British title. Then he took the Commonwealth. Then he took the European.
John, congratulations. What a magnificent night for you and for Welsh boxing.
Yes, it was. I thought it was a very good performance. And he was a very tough boy. I had this match so far, anyway.
You seem to be going as strong at the end as you were at the beginning. Did you feel that?
I couldn't catch him earlier. He's running away.
The matchstick man was about to become a contender. The world champion was waiting. Johnny Owen against the proud, vicious, arrogant Lupe Pinto. The fight would take place in Los Angeles, but not the city of Hollywood. Rather in downtown LA, Hispanic LA. This was where Pinto fought, his home turf. Johnny Owen was the complete outsider.
Well, I'll tell you, I had heard so much about Owens, and a good friend of mine saw him defend his title.
Oh, I really liked him. He was a friendly kid, quiet, you know, and a long ways from home.
When you look at him, he looks to be so thin and frail, but he's actually very strong.
Here was Johnny Owens fighting
Lupe Pinto, who was an idol throughout the world, not only because he was a Mexican national that established himself, but he was an exciting fighter.
When we were out in Los Angeles, they asked him to go sparring out there to show the public, like. And what I told him was to stand up straight and to retreat. Just retreat on the, and defend all the time. And then the tactics of the fight was to attack. So he's not giving nothing away, like. Before the fight, I went down to the gym there, and we were introduced to two big Americans, one colored and one white. And they wished John all the best of luck in the world. And they said, if you win the title, get the first bloody plane out from here.
The Olympic Auditorium, a hostile, sweltering cauldron.
Johnny Owen! Indio Lupe Pinto!
The Mexicans came in and packed the place. They were checking stuff over us, and before we had going into the ring, you know, cartons of beer and piss over it.
Bantamweight title. Pintor, a decided betting favorite here at ringside.
They are expected to obey them.
We had never seen Johnny Owens fight, so here in the United States, we thought it was ludicrous. He didn't look like he even should work in an arena where boxing was. So we believed that it would walk in and he would be knocked out. In a round or two.
We knew that Johnny was in tip-top shape. We fancied the job.
Here we go, round one. Pintor with the left. Owen is in the red trunks, trimmed in white. Pintor in white. Owen, tall, and let's face it, very thin.
From the point it started, I was very cautious in watching anything that was happening to Johnny Owens. And I just was stunned by his bravery of going into a guy like Lupe Pinto.
Johnny Owen keeps the pressure on Lupe Pinto, the WBC.
The best form of defense is attack, and he attacks from the word go. I think it shook everybody.
Well, we knew the Welsh could sing. We didn't know they could fight this good.
He started to dominate the fight. He didn't give Pinto a chance to do the things he'd do. This young man was in such fine condition that he just kept on coming and coming.
Johnny Owen, I'll tell you, he fights like a man possessed.
If I was fighting him, I would say, when are you going to go away from me?
The way it was going, John was going to be a world champion because it was a terrible, terrible mess on Pinto. His eyes, both top and bottom, were cut but very badly. I wish I knew what they had in their corner.
I think there were people in the crowd that were beginning to worry. Was this guy going to walk away with our championship from the great Lupe Pinto?
Pintor has been bloodied and cut. He has had this.
The champion was in serious trouble. He would have to dig deep to save his title.
I think Pinto may have found the key, that right hand. Somewhere along the line, Owen is going to walk into a right hand, and that's going to be it. That's
Lupe just exploded with the punch.
The first time he's been knocked out.
That one punch turned the fight around.
Public didn't know. I think his dad knew, I knew, the doctor knew. He received a laceration on the lower lip where actually the lip had severed itself from there. And the doctor remarked, God, what a laceration that is. And the father was pushing it down and says, he's all right, he's okay. And he can go on.
I could have stopped the fight because it was a bad cut, but he didn't want to show it. He'd have played hell with me if I had. They're going to be champion tomorrow night, he said. I said, I know that. And I said, you retire then. You don't have to go back in there. But things didn't turn out that way.
The 12th and final round.
Owen feeding the effect, right hand and uppercut by Fedor. Owen was down for the count of 8 in the 9th round. The only knockdown, he's down there from the right hand. 44 seconds to go here in the 12th round. That right hand nailed Johnny Owen flush on the chin. Marty Jenkins says, are you all right? So Owen down for the second time in his boxing career. The only times he's ever been down, and he's in trouble now. A right hand, and down he goes. And that, I think, will do it. Yes, we'll not get up from this one. As Lupe Tintor has won this fight and successfully defended his WBC Bantamweight Championship, he's on the shoulders of his supporters who have come into the ring. Very little security here, I might add. No police to keep these strangers out of the ring. Have no business in there, of course. 25 seconds remaining in this 12th round. The knockdown scored 35 of the 12th round.
Johnny was admitted to the Lutheran Hospital in downtown LA at 11:30 p.m. His mother flew in from Wales to join Dick at their son's bedside.
Well, he's very critically ill, but since last Tuesday, he's been progressing very, very quietly. Again this morning, there's a slight little change again in him this morning. When me and his mother was talking to him, his eyelids were fluttering as well. So I think it's something getting through. He's such a fighter. He'll pull through. I got all the confidence now. The prayers that everybody says, all out in California, yeah? And I think in every town and village throughout Great Britain. You're fantastic.
This could have happened any time during his career. And I said, why? And he said, yeah, the jawbone was thicker than a normal man, but his brain, the skull was very thin. So when he had an uppercut, it went up and just went into his brain. And he told me he'd never seen a fitter boy than him in his life.
Well, everybody has sent good wishes to us, you know. It's been marvellous.
He'll pull out for me. He's a fighter, and he'll fight. Don't you worry about it.
And then back home to Wales?
Yep. So me and his mother went to take him back.
Johnny lay in a coma on a life support machine for 46 days and nights until early November.
Went down to the hospital with John was lying there. The neurosurgeon came in and he said, I got bad news for Mr. Owens, he said. I said, what's that? He said, John is clinically dead. And I want permission to turn the machine off. But he said, I don't want an answer now. I'll come back later on. Well, we cried. We broke our bloody hearts, not cried, we broke our hearts, it did. And my wife turned to me and she said, whatever decision you make, I'll stand by. And I thought, this is awful. Again, the decision, the last decision came to me again. I thought God was being cruel to me. So after a lot of thought, I turned to my wife and I said I'd made the decision to turn the machine off. She said, "I'll stand by that." We cried.
On the 4th of November, 1980, Johnny Owen died. He was 24 years of age. Dick Owen has not seen Lupe Pintor since the night of the fight. 22 years on, he is here in Mexico City. And the father is about to meet the man who took his son's life.
English?
Let it.
Last time we couldn't speak English.
This is my wife.
In a long time.
Mucho tiempo, sí.
Everything all right for them?
¿Qué me dice?
Que quería verlo desde hace.
Ah, gracias.
Good, that's good.
¿Y usted cómo ha estado? La familia.
How is the family? How are you?
Very good, yes. It affected them all, you know, but they're climbing out of it now, like, you know.
Afectó un poquito, pero ahorita ya están mejor.
It seemed that everything that knew Johnny, it touched him somehow or another, you know. And now they're going to make a statue of John as well. Like.
Y le dio una gran pelea a la muerte, ya que nadie ha durado tanto tiempo con la situación que él estuvo, 46 días en coma. Quiere decir, y de esto demuestra que él era un guerrero y sigue siendo para mí un guerrero.
He gave a great fight against the dead, so he's very pleased that you be here. And he was very sad, a long, long year, long, long time, but he's very pleased that you be here.
Thank you. Thank you.
Muchas gracias.
Yo soy gracias, gracias.
Gracias. Creo que él es igual que el hijo, por eso el hijo salió guerrero porque él es un guerrero.
Your son was a warrior because you are a warrior.
Sí, de veras, sí. Bueno, hijos, no dejó hijos, ¿verdad?
No. Is Johnny has kids?
No, he wasn't married. Never courted anyway.
Nunca cortejó a una mujer.
I think we're both happy to meet one another. I did up in Los Angeles. Call the Mexicans rotten. I gotta be fair about that, but meeting them down here been totally different. They've been very nice people, very kind, very helpful. As something's gone behind us now, I think. We're moving on. I think so anyway, yeah. I'm glad I met him. Him and his wife and family, they're very nice. I never accused Lupe. It isn't his fault.
Ese gran corazón.
He admires you, admired you.
Gran corazón.
Because your heart
con que luchamos, con que tratamos de buscar algo, sucedió algo terrible.
That was a terrible thing.
Ese corazón aquí lo tiene.
But that heart made you what you are, a great man.
Yes, it's sad what did happen, but the way I look at it, he was such a nice boy that he was only on lend to us. And the time came for him to go.
Buena pelea y que no se siente culpable. Pasó, claro, no. Y es parte de la vida.
Parte, sí. Como dije ayer, comenté, aquí no hay un culpable.
Dick and Lupe will meet again. They will need to meet again. This one-man pilgrimage has not brought such peace after all.
It's not only me, it's the whole family. We don't think he's dead, like. When we're talking about him, we talk in the context that he's here with us. Back from Los Angeles to Heathrow, and the long journey from Heathrow down to Merthyr seemed endless it seemed. John had thousands lying in the streets, all the way up the Pond Cemetery. Some of the factories and shops shut and all for that day, so people could come. And all around you were all people. There was black with people around you.
I ask you to stand now in silence and remember one of Merthyr's sons who died fighting.
Early November 2002. Lupe and his wife have made the long journey from Mexico City to Merthyr. They have come for a church service of commemoration and the unveiling of the statue of Johnny in Merthyr town center. They will also meet Johnny's mother and brother.
Me apachurró un testículo, manita. Sí.
Luca,
Rachel.
Victoria. Nice to see you both.
How are you?
Welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome. My wife. My wife.
Mira. Hi.
Tydfil is like, don't drop me.
How are you?
When John died, Richard Workman, he painted us and he wanted to auction it there to make money there. But when we had our hands on it, we wouldn't part with it. And it's been on the wall ever since, like that.
Iba a ir a remate, pero al final ellos no quisieron desprenderse de la pintura, así que quedó siempre ahí.
Sí,
it's for you. It's a souvenir from Mexico.
Pues se rompió.
Luego le cambié la cadena, pero
okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
¿Qué te rico, eh?
Está rota. Sí. Seguro. Así como es, un día pensé.
I thought that I could come, but I never thought I would.
The nice that he has come now. Very nice.
Dice que sí. Es un placer que
hayas venido. Un hijo nace porque hay mucho amor.
A son is born because of love.
Y si un hijo muere, debe haber más amor todavía.
And when a son dies, there should be more love.
This shows the greater side of boxing. Like we've overcome a great obstacle to be together, and he's come all the way from Mexico to Wales. To do this. Now, this is different type of boxing to what Tyson had done. He did graded boxing. We and Dupuy are right, tried to lift boxing up to show what a good side of it is.
That's great.
Okay.
I don't blame him. None of the family ever have blamed him. It was just one of those things. Hey, it could have happened to Pinter just as easily. You know, and it's a paradox in boxing that you go in there to hit each other, but you don't actually go in there, you know, to do any lasting damage to anybody. It was an accident. It may seem a silly thing, but what I'm not looking forward to is shaking his hand, and that's simply because it was his right hand that did the damage.
Oh, sorry.
My son.
Ese es el hijo. Hola. Pleasure to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you very much for coming over.
Lupe, Victoria.
We appreciate it. Thank you.
Le agradecemos
Victoria.
Virginia.
And they call her Victoria. Virginia.
Este es un momento muy difícil.
Very difficult moment.
Para nosotros. Porque, bueno... pasó una tragedia. Yo no me siento culpable, ¿verdad? Fue una cosa deportiva,
because
bonita. Es algo... Todo boxeador, cuando
boxer,
subimos al ring por una oportunidad de esas, siempre pensamos
ring,
en que con la vida lo vamos a conseguir. Entonces, pasó una... desgracia, algo muy difícil.
It was something very difficult. It's a tragedy.
It was an accident. That's all. It could have happened to it. It could have happened to you just as easily. You know.
It
was an accident. That's all it was. Yeah. Mm. It's not your fault, and nobody blames you. Please don't cry. Please. Nobody blames you. Yeah. Honestly. We thank you for coming over. Nobody blames you. No one. Just an accident, pure and simple.
Come on, come on, come on.
And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
I don't blame a soul. If anybody's to blame, it's me. Could I could have stopped in that round, but it didn't, did I? Why should I go and blame it somebody else? And nobody at fault.
Eddie! My father is a a lot happier than he was, because he'd always wanted to, well, always wished there would be the statue of John, and it was never his place to start it. And there was four guys from the Ronda that started the appeal to put the statue up, and another day, his year, he's a lot happier for that.
People accepted him. Not only my family accepted him, but the people of Merthyr accepted him. Because there are lovely gestures, I think. I think it's a little girl or a woman or something, leaned forward and gave him a Welsh woolly hat and a scarf to wrap around his neck. I thought that was marvellous.
Come on, boys, you're
getting blessed. Yes, they did take to him, and he was happier too. Well, I asked him to come over, and I think he should have had the privilege of doing it, and I think it helped him a tremendous amount as well by doing it himself. And not leaving him stand by while I done it. I was satisfied just of the statue. I didn't care who unveiled it. But I think it's a printer privilege after coming 6,000 miles. Yes, it is privilege, it was, not mine. My privilege to watch and see that statue. I've waited 22 years for that.
November the 2nd. In Mexico, it is the Day of the Dead, a day to celebrate lives that have gone. In Merthyr, Johnny Owen's father, Dick, is still on his long journey. And maybe, 22 years on, he is nearer to finding peace.
I never condemned Pinter for the fight. And it helped me, and it helped Pinter. We helped one another. And that's the main part, is me and Pinter. We're the two main players in this. Because the one thing I wished that he was here with me, but you can't wish that, things like that. See? It's gone and you've got to accept it.
BBC.
Say to him, you know, I think it's going to be very emotional. I think myself, anyway.
Boxing. A link between Mexico City and Merthyr Tydfil. Two places otherwise almost impossibly far apart. Merthyr, the bleak, battered iron town with a rich history of producing boxing champions, and home to Johnny Owen. He was one of eight children, the third of five sons. When it came to sport, there was only one choice.
I was interested the boys were taking up boxing, that there wouldn't be abuse. Myself, I think everybody should do a little bit of boxing. It gives you character. It was good for John anyway. I took interest in him. I used to go down the gym to watch him.
A matchstick man, painfully slender, massively courageous. This is the story of a fight. It is also the story of a journey to Mexico to meet the man, Lupe Pintor, whose blows killed Johnny Owen. This is Dick Owen's Search for Peace.
Well, For over 21 years I've cried. And I'm hoping this will settle it all now. I'm hoping. I'd like to see Pinta now after all these years and see how he has got on, like, you know. No, I'd like to meet him now.
Va a ser un encuentro de dos amigos, creo yo. De dos amigos que algún día libramos una gran batalla, como una guerra, pero sucede. En las guerras hay muertos, hay guerras injustas. Cuando yo me encuentre con el papá de Johnny va a ser algo emocionante y va a ser algo que nos va a traer recuerdos bonitos y tristes. Pero sí, sí quiero volver a verlo.
He was not at fault for what happened to Johnny. There was a chink in John's armor which we didn't know about. Not, that's the saddest part about it. If he'd only known it. I don't know what they're going to say. I also started a gym in my own house. I had a big swing out the back and I had to put punch bags up on it and start them off, like, you know.
We did all the training together, went round fighting together, fought for Wales together. Well, I did it for about 10 years, and John obviously, when I packed in, John obviously kept on, and he was the better boxer of us all.
John was devoted to it. The amount of time that he put into it, like, you know. It's easy to train John, the hardest part was to stop him training.
I knew he was a very good boy, but he was so small, very small, but when he's about 15, 16, but he's thin, small. He was a flyweight for a long time, but he matured into a bantamweight, and then, you know, we had a good boy. There's something special about him.
Johnny, how are you going to approach this fight?
Just like I do all the others.
How's that?
Dick Owen is a long way from home. 22 years ago in September 1980, his son Johnny Owen fought for a world boxing title. He fought and died. Dick was in Johnny's corner that night. The father was also his son's trainer. Johnny Owen, the Merthyr